A very good morning to all the students, program in charges and regional directors. This is the second teleconferencing of the June batch, July batch for healthcare waste management. I welcome you all. We shall be discussing the course 2 of the healthcare waste management program today. Let me first introduce the guest for today. On my right is Dr. Megha Rathi. She is a freelance consultant in the area of healthcare waste management and environment. She has also worked as a consultant with our school for developing this program, and today she will be taking the topic, the second and the third sessions. Now on my left, I have Dr. Sumati Muralidharan. She's a microbiologist in Safdarjung Hospital, and she has also been associated very closely with the program. She is one of the academic counselors in Safdarjung Hospital, which is also our program study center for the program of healthcare waste management. So to begin with, I will request Dr. Sumati to start her topic, and that is occupational safety and patient safety. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Kuba. Today we will begin with this very important topic in healthcare waste management, that is occupational hazards and patient safety. Now, let us first find out who are the people who are involved in this and to whom the hazards are applicable. Firstly, to the healthcare workers. So anybody who's working in the hospital setup is as a healthcare worker is capable of getting in contact with the having problems with these health hazards, and then the patients, then to the community at large, and also to the environment. And if it affects the environment, in turn that will affect the people concerned. So what are the types of healthcare hazards? The healthcare hazards could be physical pollutants, chemical pollutants, biological pollutants, and radiological pollutants. And each of these pollutants will in turn cause the respective hazards. That is, the physical pollutants will lead to physical hazards. And here a few examples are placed here, but we'll go into a little more detail of all that. Under the physical hazards, we have needles, glass, scalpels, sharp edges, basically the sharp instruments that could be implicated. Then we have the chemical hazards, which may be due to the toxic gases, chemicals, reagents, dyes, and drugs. The biological hazards, as all of us are aware, are due to the microorganisms which are disease-causing, like they can be bacteria, viruses, fungi, or parasites. And the radioactive hazards include the radioactive chemicals. Now, among the physical pollutants, let us go a little more in detail. We all know that many of the big hospitals have got incinerators, and these incinerators have got certain dangers. I mean, they can pose to be hazardous to the health of the healthcare workers and others around. So that's because of the pollutants like the fly ash, residual ash, the particulate matter, that is the sharps, etc. Then there could be persistent organic pollutants and needle stick injuries, because some of the sharps and all that, if they get included. But other than the incinerator, the needle stick injuries are also categorized under physical pollutants. Then there could be acid gases, which could cause eye irritation and respiratory illness. So sharps are a very major part of the physical pollutants and physical hazardous materials. So let's go a little more in detail about sharps. The sharps can cause both injury as well as infection. So it's a kind of a dual hazard to the healthcare workers. They can cause injury. Sharps can cause cuts and lacerations and wounds, and they can also cause infection, because like needle stick injuries, they are capable of transmitting some of the infections, which again we'll deal with a little later. And who are the people in whom this is common? Hospital staff. Among the hospital staff, especially the doctors, the nurses, the laboratory technicians, and people who are commonly involved with, giving injections or with, who are dealing with sharp items, mainly the needles. And then we have in the community the rag pickers, who all of us are aware, they can also have the danger of getting sharps injury, because they are rummaging through the dumps where sharps could be a big danger. And the procedures which cause needle stick injuries in the healthcare setup is usually drawing of blood, recapping the needles, needle disposal, and garbage disposal. And diseases transmitted include HIV, hepatitis B virus, and hepatitis C virus. These are the three infections which are usually dreaded by the for needle stick injuries. Now, the occupational exposures, it has been estimated by studies that the risk of transmission of blood-borne viruses to healthcare workers for HIV, percutaneous exposure, it's about 0.4%, while for hepatitis B, it is as high as 9.3%, and for hepatitis C, it's about 3.1%.
And Dr. Smriti, before we go ahead, I think this sharp injuries is a very important subject, and also prevention is very much possible. So can you just elaborate a little bit on how to prevent the sharp injuries?
I have gone into it a little later in the slides, but let me mention it right now also, that first of all, appropriate training is very important. And before that, there is what is called as the hierarchy of controls, which I'll come to a little later, where if, as far as possible, try and avoid using sharps. If you can have a better alternative, try and use that. So that's one way of avoiding sharps injury, the most important way, in fact. And apart from that, you have to train the healthcare workers as to how to handle the sharps and to use appropriate techniques and not to recap the needles.
Then what should they do if they don't need to recap?
If at all they have to recap this, we advise the one-hand technique, where you use only one hand and then you slip the needle into the cap if at all you have to recap. Mm. But nowadays, what we train them is not to recap the needles. You just have to disinfect and put it, or we have the needle destroyers. Yeah. Mm-hmm. So these are all ways of avoiding
the needle destroyer. They should keep it nearer to the place of origin.
Where the sharp is being generated.
Yeah.
So these are very important things. So,
anything else you would like to add?
She's covering it.
Okay. I have a few slides on it later also. Then we have the chemical pollutants, which include acids, alcohols, you have aldehydes, phenols, and heavy metals. And the effects of all these are, as is given over here, they can be due to the corrosive action. You can have the toxic action of these chemicals. They could cause burns in the healthcare workers if they are not careful in handling them. And they could be carcinogenic, that is capable of causing cancers, or genotoxic, that is capable of causing genetic defects, or mutagenic, that is capable of causing mutations. So these are some of the chemical pollutants which can cause chemical hazards. Then the sources of these infectious agents in waste, that is, we are coming to the biological pollutants now. So where are these biological pollutants coming from? Where do they originate? One is the operation theatres, and where surgeries are being performed, whether it's the minor operation theatre or the major operation theatres. Then you have the isolation wards or even the general wards. Then culture stocks from laboratories. So laboratories, especially the microbiology laboratory, where dangerous organisms or the infectious organisms are being cultured, that is, they are being grown. And in such places, they can have waste which are generated and which could be highly infectious. And we have the labor rooms, where plenty of placenta and other parts are being generated every day. The mortuaries, where postmortems are being performed. Then you have tissues from the pathology laboratories. So all these are some of the sources of biological pollutants or infectious agents. So some of the organisms, names of organisms which can occur in these healthcare wastes and cause infections, they include staphylococci, the pseudomonas, Escherichia coli, Klebsiella, Proteus. These are all names of bacteria which are very commonly prevalent, especially in the hospital setup. In fact, they are some of the important causes of nosocomial infections or hospital-acquired infections. Then we have, among the viruses, we have the HIV, or the human immunodeficiency virus, that is a causative of the dreaded AIDS disease. And then we have the hepatitis B and hepatitis C viruses, which are also implicated in these infections.
I think it's also important to mention here that nosocomial infections normally are very difficult to treat also, because most of the organisms are resistant to most of the antibiotics which are prescribed. So
that that's why, you know, every hospital has to have its own policies. You have to have an infection control committee and form policies for antibiotic usage, policies for waste handling. So it's always better to have these committees in place so that, you know, infections,
procedures are
these kind of dangerous, multi-drug resistant infections are don't, you know, take over.
And the universal precautions have to be taken care of.
Yeah, that's very important. In fact, there is a bit of that also in the... classification of waste. This is just to go back and to highlight as to what kind of wastes are usually being generated in the hospital setup. We have the non-infectious and the infectious waste. So I want you to just pay attention to the percentages of both these wastes. Please notice that the non-infectious waste is 80%, whereas the infectious or the biohazardous waste is only 20%. But this 20% is very important, because if we don't segregate the wastes properly and don't keep them apart, the non-infectious and infectious, then we'll end up with 100% of infectious waste, which would be very difficult to handle. So segregation is a very important process in the process of healthcare waste management. Now, infectious waste again could be sharps and non-sharps. So the sharps have to be collected separately in puncture-proof containers, so they are dealt with differently. And the non-sharps are again, they could be sent to the incinerator. And we also have a category of biohazardous waste which is non-infectious. Like that includes the radioactive waste, the chemical waste, cytotoxic, and the pressurized containers. This again is just a representation of you know, the percentages of different types of waste. Here I would like you to bring your notice to the blue color, that is the 1% waste, which is sharps. So remember, the sharps form a very small percentage of the waste, that is, it's just about 1%, but it causes 90% of the needle stick injuries and the hazards that are caused by the physical pollutants. So the sharps are very important, because although it's just 1% of the total content of waste, it causes more than 90% of infections and the needle stick injuries. So it's it has to be dealt with appropriately. Now, what are the risks to the health to the healthcare workers from the wastes? Sharps cause needle stick injuries, as I've elaborated earlier. Then the incineration again has the pollutant gases and some of the unburnt the particulate matter, which could cause air pollution. That has to be taken care of. Then you have the injuries like back and joint injuries, respiratory illnesses in persons who are working in such setups. There could be direct contact with some of these pollutants, and there could be injuries at dumps, headache, nausea, lead poisoning. All these are possible, and they are all risks with healthcare wastes. And there is also the element of environmental hazards, that is, environmental health. Here it can affect the groundwater by seeping into, if we are not careful about how we are disposing of all the waste, it could contaminate the groundwater. And vector-borne diseases can also be common. Volatile organic emissions can be there. The animals feeding on the healthcare waste can also be affected, and there could be stagnant water, which again can be hazardous. In fact, there is a session on water waste management, so we'll deal with that a little later.
Over here, I would like to say that, about mercury poisoning also. Have you discussed it elsewhere, or we can discuss it? The importance.
We can discuss it here.
Would you like to say something? Yeah.
Yes, we've already discussed on the heavy metals. I guess mercury is one of the most dangerous heavy metal that's there in the healthcare facilities, and especially we've discussed in the other teleconferences also. We need to take care of mercury from wherever it's been generated, and especially at the time of disposal. In case we break a thermometer or at least
sphygmomanometer, BP apparatus,
In that case, we need to make sure that we just don't dispose of the mercury into the water stream, water, or put it into the dustbins, but rather we collect it together by, we don't have a presentation, so we need to collect it very meticulously and send it back to the store. So it's there in your course material, but how do we do it is we have to make sure that we don't have a direct contact with mercury. We need to wear two pairs of gloves and then collect it in a syringe and put it in the water with some water, in a bottle with some water, because it's heavier than water, it will stay there, and then we send it to the stores who can send it back to the manufacturers. We need to make sure that we contain mercury within the hospitals and not dispose it of anywhere in the environment, outside the environment, or even the hospital environment. There are certain studies that have been done by an NGO called Toxics Link, which have found that the mercury contamination of mercury within the hospitals in the environment is
much higher than
what has been recommended. So we need to make sure that we contain the mercury wherever it's been disposed of.
And but very common in these dental,
even in the dental
systems also.
Although now they are trying to go in for other cementing materials.
But what is the great hazard that mercury poses if it is there in the environment? I think that also we need to discuss.
Mercury, because it's in a solid form that we generally see, but it can easily, it's a volatile, it gets into a gaseous methyl mercury. It enters the water bodies, and through the water bodies, the biomagnification, it enters through the fissures and the water, water bodies, it enters into our systems.
And it's not and easily excreted by the human system, so it becomes
basically, it is not easily excreted at all, and there's one more thing, it doesn't follow the blood-brain barrier, so it can easily go through the placenta into the baby.
In fact, the central nervous system is one of the major parts or organs which are affected by the mercury. So you end up having a whole lot of central nervous system effects. That's the danger with
and of course it affects your, the different thing that nervous system is affected, so gradually it's affecting each and every part of your body. And so the symptoms could be slow handwriting, and gradually how to detect mercury pollution, because I guess the healthcare workers are really prone to the mercury pollution within the hospital environment. So they need to make sure that they contain the mercury, and it's good for them plus the environment also. So
at this point of time I would like to send across a message, that is, infection prevention and control is the responsibility of every healthcare worker, irrespective of discipline, role or grade. So it doesn't matter how senior or junior a person is, or the senior most doctors or nurses need not think that it's not their responsibility, and that healthcare waste management and the disposal is all to be done by the karamcharis or maybe the other sisters and junior residents and things like that. So it is the responsibility of every person who's generating the waste. It is their responsibility to see that it is segregated and that the waste is disposed of appropriately. So this is commitment to this cause is extremely important in every hospital setup. Now, what are the merits of managing waste? It minimizes the spread of infection. It reduces the risk of accidental injury to staff and others. It creates an aesthetically pleasing atmosphere. Reduces pests like insects and animals. It reduces contamination of soil and groundwater with chemicals and microorganisms. And it reduces malodors. So it's very important that everybody is involved in managing healthcare waste. Now, there has to be a culture of safety. Every hospital has to take care of the occupational health of its its employees, and the medical waste management has to have a separate department, and it has to be managed by concerned individual. A safety of waste management officer should necessarily be appointed in every healthcare institution, and the environment protection. So if we follow these methods meticulously and dispose of the healthcare waste in an appropriate manner, then we will also ensure environment protection.
I think it's also important to state here that every hospital may not be having the facilities for waste management ultimately, but to have the knowledge how the waste is managed and to segregate the waste and then maybe to send it to a central facility.
Yeah, central
itself is a very important thing. You need not have the whole system in place, but the knowledge and the
knowledge is important.
Knowledge is very important.
Attitude
and
also.
Attitude is important, and of course you should then at least be able to segregate and send it to the right place.
Yeah, but even for that, I mean, forming a committee or the infection control committee itself could do it, or there could be a separate waste management. Usually in hospitals, there is the infection control committee or the ICC. And the waste management is a part of that. So one officer is usually designated for that.
And I've seen that systems really work when the senior, as you said, the senior staff need to be involved in the waste management.
Yeah.
The administrative staff. Otherwise, it doesn't work. So it is the responsibility.
Yeah,
the
it senior has to trickle down from the above.
Yeah, it doesn't work. Yeah. Monitoring, actually. Monitoring is really important here again.
So we can continue.
Now coming to some of the steps to improve occupational safety. Firstly, as I mentioned earlier, commitment. There should be a commitment, and one has to allot time to these activities. Then there has to one has to give a lot of energy to it and the resources. Administrative support is a must. Usually in hospitals, the heads of the institution, say a medical superintendent or a director or whatever post he or she is called by, the person has to be extremely committed to this cause. So unless they feel the need for this, they may not allot appropriate funds, or they may not see the need for allotting resources or funds to this cause if they feel that it's not necessary. So it's very important for the head of the institution, whether it's a small nursing home or a hospital or a big tertiary care center, whatever it may be, the head of the institution has to be convinced and committed to the cause of healthcare waste management and to the cause of the occupational safety of all his employees, that is the healthcare workers. And then the hazards have to be identified. So maybe he could form a committee, as I was saying, the infection control committee or the infection control team, and then usually the head of the institution is the head of this committee, and then he allots, he makes subcommittees and allots different responsibilities to different people, like usually the surgeon, the head of the medicine unit, and a microbiologist are always involved in these committees. And of course, the head of the nursing staff, that is maybe the nursing superintendent, could also be involved. And so they all get together, they have frequent meetings, maybe they meet once a month or so. And then apart from the infection control practices, they are also involved with the waste management practices. So they have to identify hazards, and maybe they could appoint people to make these walk-through inspections. That means people who are appointed for this purpose, they take a walk in the wards, in the OTs, and wherever necessary, and inspect very minutely and see where the need is for improving, and what are the kinds of wastes that are generated at each point, and how they could be disposed of appropriately. So a walkthrough inspection is a must, and it has to be taken frequently, because the kind of change, the waste that is generated could be changing from time to time. So they have to be aware of these aspects. And then they have to, after making these walkthrough inspections, they will be aware of what kind of wastes are being generated and what are the hazards to the, the safety of the healthcare workers. So then they evaluate the hazards, and then they have to train personnel. So this is a very important aspect. Training personnel to manage the waste appropriately and to again be committed to this cause, that again is an important task of the the healthcare, senior staff who are part of the infection control committee. Then they have to strategize and find out what are the control measures to implement. So the control strategies have to be in place. And of course, meticulous record keeping is also important, because they have to tell the staff when they're training them that they have to report any of the accidents, and all this is has to be kept on record so that they can evaluate, and each time they can go back to the records and try and improve subsequently. So these are very important measures for improving the occupational safety in the healthcare waste management. And infection control measures, now I will just enumerate some of them. Standard precautions are very important. We just touched upon it earlier. then handling of sharps, personal protective equipment, engineering controls. I've just given an example of elbow operated taps, and transport facilities, SOPs or standard operating procedures for equipment handling and immunization. So these are all in a sense the infection control measures every hospital has to take care of.
Go on to the next slide. Dr. Sumati, would you over here like to mention something about post-exposure counseling for sharps especially? Like what is its importance and
whether it is part of
the infection control procedures or the committees which are formed, is it one of the activities?
That's once the person has had a sharp injury. Usually after a sharps injury, now with the problem of AIDS being such a big scare, so after the sharps injury we have a full protocol. And the healthcare worker who has had a sharps injury will usually report it to a senior or how they have to handle it immediately. Mm. They are supposed to clean the part, they have to express, if it has bled, they have to express it. First of all, it depends on whether they are wearing gloves or not wearing gloves at the time of the sharps injury. Usually what we find is some of the junior staff, that is the residents and interns, they are the ones who come to us mostly because while they are withdrawing blood or they are all so much pressurized and the workload is so much, you know, so these kind of injuries are quite common. So then they get really scared and say, I don't know if the patient is HIV positive, so what am I supposed to do? So we advise them firstly not to panic, then they have to remove the gloves that they've been wearing and then assess the injury to see if it has drawn blood, and if it has, they have to express it out a little bit and then immediately wash the area and clean it. So if you have Savlon or any other disinfectant or spirit or whatever you may be having, Dettol or something, clean it with that, or if not, anything, plain soap and water is also quite effective. Because some of these viruses are quite amenable to, treatment with all this. So they have to clean the part and all that. And then they report it to a senior staff. And it is put on record because what kind of procedure was carried out and all that we have to know. After that, the patient from whom, the source that is, so we try and find out the infection status of the source. So they send the blood samples for HIV, hepatitis B and C to the laboratory, and then their own baseline titers are also done. So this is how it is done. And then for HIV, if it's a known case of HIV positive person from whom they have had the needle stick injury, then we put them on the ART, that is the antiretroviral treatment drugs. So we have an ART clinic, and the casualty medical officer is the one who advises on all this. So we keep the drugs ready. And the first dose is given right away, and after that the person takes the course for about 4 weeks or so. And at the end of it, again the blood tests of the person, for HIV I'm saying. So the blood tests are again done at the end of 6 weeks and then again 12 weeks.
So how frequent are these sharp injuries which are reported in your hospital?
Quite frequent. Every day they occur. So not that they are being reported every day, but I think maybe in a week about 5 to 6 cases, okay. or maybe more. As I said, it's mostly the residents.
How many of them, like these repeat tests, have some been found to be HIV positive after sharp injuries?
So far none of them. I mean, thankfully none, but it's always safe to take the precautions. In fact, we have had HIV positive persons who have had
blood has been taken, but
the sharps injury has occurred. And so we have as a prophylactic measure, we put them on drugs and all that. We've gone through the courses, but it's not really
that they have not been found
they have not found to be positive.
So were these injuries which were there, they had drawn blood and all also?
Many of them had drawn blood. They had used gloves. And many a time what happens is it occurs when the person is drawing the blood. Because the interns are, pretty hard pressed for time, and they have to draw blood from a lot of patients. The kind of inner government setup in a big tertiary care hospital, the kind of patient load we have. So when they draw the blood, usually that's the time they get these injuries, or putting in an IV cannula or something like that.
For hepatitis B, they've been vaccinated.
Usually, yeah, all healthcare workers are given the hepatitis B vaccine, but some of these students and staff who are not permanent staff, you know, they have to make arrangements. Of course, we do have the.
It's important to have them vaccinated.
But is it the policy of the hospital that everybody has to be vaccinated?
Healthcare workers are right now. It's not been made mandatory.
Yeah.
But. It's an optional thing, but the facility is available. So more and more people should.
The transmission of hepatitis B, as you said, is more than HIV.
In fact, the transmission of hepatitis B and C is in fact much higher than for HIV AIDS. But the hype and the fear people have is more for HIV AIDS because it doesn't have an effective vaccine.
The test for HIV, you do the test for HIV, you don't do the test for hepatitis B.
Hepatitis B antigen also we have the test. The ELISA tests are being done.
But that is not routinely done.
It's not routinely done.
Okay.
So no, but the risk is more actually.
We should be doing that.
Yeah, we are doing that also. Mm-hmm. In fact,
I think in very few of them you will have to do because most of them would have anyway been vaccinated.
Yes.
So at least in those who have not been vaccinated, maybe.
Instead of doing the antigen detection, it's much more useful to get the antibody titers done. So because if they've been vaccinated, then the titers will be high, and then they don't have to really bother much.
Yeah. So I think that's important. I think that's a good point that the hepatitis B also you can consider and
yes,
you can talk about. More actually, the transmission of hepatitis B is more.
Surely.
Yeah.
Okay. So coming now to the hierarchy of controls, there is what is called as the hierarchy of controls, where one has to eliminate the hazard as far as possible. That is the best process, as you can see in the chart here. The best thing is to eliminate a hazard. Let me give you the example of needle stick injuries. So if there is an option of not giving an injection, I think that would be the best thing to do. If you can, for example, instead of giving an injection, if you can treat a patient with oral drugs, then you better do that because there is always the hazard in case of giving an injection. So eliminating the hazard is the first thing. If you are not able to do that and you have to give injections, then maybe you can substitute it with a less hazardous option, or you can use technology to remove the hazard. These days you get the auto-disabled syringes and needles, auto-disabled injections, which is often used for the immunization programs. And if that also cannot be done, then you can go for the work practice controls. You can practice work practice controls where you train the person how to do it. For example, giving injections, you train the nurse, you train the residents, you train all the people who are implicated in this activity. You train them so that they do it appropriately and don't get any injury or hazard to themselves. And the last would be for them to use personal protective equipment. In fact, many of them are using this as a first option. That is, they wear gloves for giving injections and all that. So this should not be the first thing that one should think of. So, but then this is one of the options also. So that's about the hierarchy of controls. Now, what are standard precautions? We've been talking about standard precautions just now. We've been discussing about that. Standard precautions are the precautions that are consistently used for all patients regardless of their bloodborne infection status, as most of the individuals with HIV, HPV or CV are often asymptomatic, which means one has to take standard precautions for any kind of patient you are dealing with. Always think that whenever you are dealing with a patient, you must assume that they are infectious to you. So then only you will take the precautions. So you have to assume that every patient is infectious, irrespective of their actual status, and then you take the precaution for all patients. Not that if you know that a patient is HIV positive, only then I'll put on my gloves, only then I'll take precautions. That should not be the policy. So standard precautions means it's a standard procedure. You have to take precautions whatever the kind of patient you handle. Now, the benefits of standard precautions are reduced risk to the patients, reduced risk to healthcare workers, reduced transmission of hospital-acquired infections or HAIs, reduced risk to visitors and attendants, and the standard precautions include hand washing, barrier precautions, collection of laboratory specimens appropriately, handling spills, patient placement, transport, sterilization and disinfection procedures, the waste management and immunization of healthcare workers. So all these are a part of the standard precautions, and especially the last mention, that is immunization, is very important. As we were talking, most healthcare workers, since they are always at risk of getting infections within the hospital setup, they have to be immunized and to some of the diseases, at least where the vaccines are available, like for tetanus and hepatitis B, every healthcare worker has to be immunized. Coming to the safety measures for waste handlers, they could wear protective clothing and gear, like put on gloves, use aprons, masks, caps and boots wherever necessary. Especially boots and all are very important for the waste handlers. And hand washing, of course, how it has to be done, how often it has to be done, when it has to be done, this is all being taught. In fact, this is more of a common sense procedure. Everybody knows that you have to wash hands, but how do you do it, how correctly do you do it, that's very important. And sharps handling, then you have handling of spills, all this has to be, it's part of the standard precautions, of course. Accident reporting, we've already gone through this earlier. Transportation, post-exposure prophylaxis. We've touched upon this topic also.
Are you having certain training programs, short training programs for the waste handlers or for the doctors separately?
Yes, we do.
Do you have some short?
Yes, we do. In fact, we routinely have what is called as the infection prevention week.
Okay.
So in 1 week's time, that is Monday to Friday, it's usually done on a Monday to Friday schedule. And on Mondays, it's for the doctors, Tuesdays for the nurses, and maybe the next day, Wednesday, for the laboratory technicians, Thursdays for the karamcharis, usually that's divided into two groups, and one day maybe for the residents also.
And how doctor. Often is this week celebrated? Once a year?
Usually once a year it's happening, but I would wish that it was
Because it needs to be reinforced. I mean, once
especially in certain categories of
especially the waste handlers and all, if once they are exposed, then everything may not seep into them.
Yeah,
and I think
and we do have a very good waste management system in place in our at our hospital, where the doctor who's in charge of the waste management processes, she takes a round every now and then and sees if people are putting the, you know, the right waste into the right bin, color-coded
that is there, but I think more important is, as you said, the wash and handing, washing of
hand
the hands,
and
you know, picking up the spills and all, that is something which is very individualistic.
Yeah, they have to be trained on that.
And just by, I think, one day training, I mean, they will, an attitudinal change.
Yeah, I agree, it's not really enough.
Actually, but we were discussing giving more emphasis on the topic, you know. So
yeah, but we do have other training programs where this becomes a part, like the infection training, infection prevention week is different. But apart from that, we have what's called as our annual sentinel surveillance and all that, where we train people in, you know, actually we do it for HIV, AIDS and STDs and all. But as part of that, hospital waste management is always a lecture which is included in these also.
I think so you can also show the films, like the films that we have on waste,
the video,
you know,
films.
Videos that we have for this program itself, like the CPCP videos and the WHO videos, because it will give more of an impact. And I think it's a very good opportunity for us to tell the students, because we have one full block on, you know, training of the waste handlers. So that is something that we are teaching them in any case.
Yeah, one only has to concentrate on, you know, catch them young, they say.
Yeah.
So you have to train the lower staff and the junior staff so that they don't end up, because once habits are already formed, it's very difficult to change.
And
once
also the curriculum, I would just, you know, like to talk about it. It has to be a part of the curricula, as you're saying.
Yeah.
The nursing curricula and the doctor MBBS.
It's very important.
It has to be there.
In fact, now our nursing superintendent has seen the need for this, and she, in fact, requested me that the new batch of nurses that's coming now, it's a batch of 100 and.
The Nursing Council of India has already included it as
so
a part.
So we have to include
curricula.
This to them.
It's already a part of the nursing council.
So, in a nutshell, immunization, segregation, labeling, leak-proof secure containers, storage and transportation, training, supervision, all this is in a nutshell a part of waste management. So the message to the healthcare workers would be, improving patient safety is about changing the culture in healthcare from one of blame to one where we examine our systems from beginning to end and reduce the opportunities for mistakes. So this would be my take-home message to all of you. And please remember, prevention is primary. Protect the patients, protect healthcare personnel, and ultimately promote quality healthcare. So this should be our goal, and this is what we would want every healthcare institution to implement.
I think that's a very, very important message that you have given, and that prevention is really very important, because once the damage is done, then it takes
very difficult.
It takes much more, not only time,
cost
as well as, you know, stress, mental stress to cure the damage that has been done. So prevention is the real key. And as you said, the if we can avoid using the sharps, avoid using things which are creating the waste, that is the best way to do it. So anything else you would like to add? Or? Okay, so I would like to thank Dr. Sumati, and then we'll have a 15 minutes break, and then we'll again join you at 12 for the next session. Thank you.
Thank you.